My name is Torsten Overgaard. I'm a Danish photographer. I travel the world taking photographs and teaching photography. Today I will talk about the 35mm APO. The Leica 35mm APO for the Leica M system is a lens that I fundamentally don't need. Still, I keep looking for if I can find one somewhere. They're kind of hard to get hold of, but as I said, I don't need it. But let's just talk about it anyways. actually, I had different 35mm through the years, and there is a lot of exciting 35mm. Leica came with the 35 1.4 with floating elements in about 10 years ago, and that was like a big lens at that point, meaning like it was a big news. It was like a fantastic lens, and it still is a fantastic lens. And that, of course, is one of the problems, that the 35 1.4 is a fantastic lens, and now there's a 35 APO 2.0 that is also a fantastic lens. Then there is other interesting 35mm in the back catalog. Actually, that the normal 35 2.0 is a great lens, and it has been for a long time, and it's compact, and it's not that expensive. It works really well on a Leica M. But there is the tendency that if you have Leica, you want to have the most extreme, the most amazing. So that's why the 35 2.0 haven't been that popular as it should be, because it really have a beautiful 3D looking image, very high clarity, details and everything. It's a great lens, but generally, if you get that one, then the next thing you dream about is the 35 1.4, because it's just one stop wider, more extreme, and it's still, but it is like a really, really well-made lens. Then you can go even further back. You can take the 35 1.4 double aspherical. So that is like the previous aspherical, and it's handmade aspherical, so it's hand-grinded. So it means that the quality of the lens, or the sharpness, the clarity and whatever, goes up and down from lens to lens. So one thing is that you have to find one, and it's a collector's item, so they're kind of expensive, like from $10,000 and up. And so first you have to find one, and then you have to find a good one. Or you have to find one and then believe that it's a good one. Because you're not really going to compare it to anything else. You're just going to decide this is good. So I had that one also. And I've also had there is also the 35 King of Bokeh, which means that it has a very sparkling bokeh. The background out of focus, things will look really amazing. And you could say it's something that was big. It's still kind of big, still kind of a cool effect, but the tendency in lens design is that out of focus becomes smoother and smoother, and you don't have any sharp edges or anything. It just becomes very silky and smooth. And that's definitely also the direction the new 35 have gone. And then, of course, there's 35 2.0, the good old ones in silver, for example, that I also had. Very compact, very smooth. It feels very like a M rangefinder style. It feels very old school photography, and they're not that expensive. So lots of possibilities in 35mm, and I have basically had a lot of these. And at some point, I just decided I'm not using 35. So I used to travel around with a bag with maybe five lenses, and I would tend to have a 35mm and a 90, and sometimes a 21 or 28 or something. It would vary a little bit. And one of the things I realized is like I never put on this 35mm. It's just not my lens. I've done an article also that I used the 35 1.4, and I forced myself to use it as a game. I forced myself to use it for 3 or 4 weeks for everything I did. And it actually worked really well, because the 35 1.4 FLE is so detailed, crisp and fantastic lens that you can always just crop the picture. So even I was used to using a 50, when I put on the 35, I could just crop it to 50. Not a problem. So that's how great that lens is. But Generally, I like 50 millimeter, and what I do mostly is I travel around with 50 millimeter. So I have the Noctlux 0.95, I have 1.4. Currently, I have this exactly also as 35. This is 7 Artisans 1.4 that I'm trying out. I'm not fantastic amazed by it. I think it's very big. And I don't think it's like, I mean, it's an inexpensive lens. It doesn't have anything super sexy special about it. It doesn't have a special look like the 51.1 from 7 Artisans that I really liked. So it's kind of like a 35 1.4. In the cheap end, it's bulky, and it's not anywhere near by like a 35 1.4. So, but generally, I am a 50 millimeter person, and I'm still looking if there's a 35 upper, so that tells something about the problems we are faced with here. The thing is, normally when people ask me, they will send me an email or will ask me like, I'm getting my first Leica, should I get an M9 or M240, should I get this or that? And the next thing is, which lens should I have? And very few people will go buy two or three Leica lenses to begin with, and I actually don't recommend that. I think like one should focus with one lens, and it's also, it's almost like built into the Leica M system that you have one camera and one lens and you can do everything with it. It doesn't mean that you just stay with one lens. I mean, no, it's really hard to just stay with one lens. You want to try other lenses. And the 35 APO is one where you're like, yeah, I want to try that. Even if you know it's not my lens, I'm still going to stay with it. But people will ask me, what lens should I get? And it's actually very simple to decide what lens you should have, because you can look back at the photos you used to take with a zoom or whatever camera you had, and you can see, am I a wider person or am I like 50? So it's like, do I like to shoot things 35 millimeter or do I like the more tunnel vision, more straight lines and compact 50 millimeter? And that's the one you go. Very few people will go that they like 28 millimeter as the standard lens or they like 80 or 75 millimeter. Most people are either 35 or 50, and it's also the two most sold lenses for the Leica system. Traditionally, the 50 millimeter was the one that Leica was made for. So if you take the rangefinder here on a Leica, if you don't know it, wait, it you turn the focus here and it presses a little wheel in here, and that makes this eye have to match. So it's a very manual focusing system that simply just sits in here and is activated by this moving piece of metal here when you turn the focus. So it's very, you could say, very analog, very mechanical. And that whole rangefinder system was made for the 50 millimeter because Leica started out with 50 millimeter lenses on the first cameras. And then later came 35, and I would say in the 60s, 70s, kind of like 35 became popular for whatever reason. Maybe it's like you could capture more in the photo or something. But it have always kind of been the choice between 35 or 50 millimeter. So that's the first choice you have to make, is am I a 35 or 50 millimeter person? And then you go for that lens. The next thing is, should it be 2.0 or 1.4? And a lot of people will say, well, I'm buying a new camera and a lens and I kind of want to economize and I'm not so good at this yet, so I'll just go with a 2.0. And that's fine in a way, but what often happens is that you really want the 1.4 because it's in the whole Leica idea and maybe in the photography idea that you want to have the most perfection. So you dream about the 1.4 and you buy a 2.0, so you're going to still dream about 1.4, so you're not really going to be happy with 2.0. And that's why you say you should actually go with 1.4 to begin with. So that's basically the simplicity of it. Then of course you can go 0.95, that's like a special treat or a special way of doing it. I went with the Noctlux 1.0 and then the 1.4, or the 0.95. And that's a lens I've used a lot. It's almost been welded to my camera for several years. In recent times, I've gone with the 50 1.4 here for compactness, and also because I almost feel like I owe to use this lens, and it really works for me. But the other thing is 50, and still I'm looking for a 35 APO 2.0. So What are we getting ourselves into here? I mean, so there is the idea of having an Apple lens is something that comes from the Taylor lenses. So if you go back and look at the Leica R lenses, the 400 millimeter lenses and stuff like that, long tail lenses, you would use ARPO. So ARPO is simply just correct the light rays. So when you look with your eyes, but all your, especially when you take a photo, you're working with red, green, and blue. That's the three colors. And they have to meet on the sensor. And even the sensor is divided up in red, green, and blue also. So it happens that the red light travels a little bit different. It's actually slower. I mean, we have speed of light, but apparently that doesn't really apply to red or something like that. So it means that red tilts off, but basically all colors tilt off if you take a long tail lens. So that's why they came up with ARPO. And ARPO is basically just that you have normal lenses like this, and then you put on correction lenses so you direct the rays. That's basically what happens. And the result is that you get higher precision. And what does that mean? Well, it's not really sharpness, but it's clarity. It is like that things stand out really alive. And if we look at the history of when Leica started to use ARPO in shorter lenses, because that's the whole new concept that is fairly new, and Leica is taking it to the extreme right now that they're making ARPO lenses of like anything. And that's a great idea because it does add clarity. But 15, 20 years ago, the idea of making a standard lens of 50 or 35 millimeter with ARPO was sort of like ridiculous. That's even what lens designer Peter Carpenter at Leica said. And Leica did make a 90 millimeter ARPO 2.0, and if you look at the pictures that that lens takes, it's just outstanding clarity of colors. It's like, I usually say that it have more clarity to the colors and the whole image than when you look at it with your eyes. It's very special. Then Peter Carpenter made the 75 2.0 ARPO. That is kind of like an underrated lens. It's an amazing lens. When it came out, it was almost like people said, no, it's not really great for portrait. It's too sharp. It's like too high contrast. It's not that it's like edge sharp, but it just have high contrast and clarity. So it's almost like it wouldn't ruin a face. It would just show too much of a face, more than you would like to have. So still an amazing, great lens. Then Peter Carpe, actually 16 years ago, he made the 50. 1.4 is this one. And this one is not an ARPO lens, except that it is. There is an interview on my website where he tells that it is actually an ARPO construction, but he thought it was so ridiculous at the time to write ARPO on the lens. It's like that he didn't, you know. And then it moves on from there. The idea with ARPO takes shape. You also have in a lens, you have aspherical elements. That's also a thing that has been added kind of for a long time, but it is kind of like new technology, because this is where instead of grinding a lens like this, you can actually push it. And Leica have a patent on doing that. So suddenly you can make a lens like whatever. You could make it Fresnel waves if you wanted to direct the light whichever you want, where you want. And of course, it's all aiming at correcting lines that nothing is going in weird directions, but everything is nice and straight, high clarity, and it has to work in all aperture levels and all focusing distances. So it's like a whole thing, and you could say we as users of lenses doesn't have to know all these things or know why is it that this new 35 ARPO is so amazing and fantastic. There is an interview with Peter Carpenter that Leica did themselves, where he explains some of this, and one of the things Peter Carpenter have been doing in lens design is that for the Leica SL system or the L lenses, they have made ARPO, like a whole, the idea is to make a whole series of ARPO lenses. And now you can see it's also gonna happen in the M system. If you look at the M system, they're gonna be a Noxlook series and they're gonna be an ARPO series, that's for sure. That's the direction they're going, they're like rolling that out. So the great thing is that Peter Carpenter is the one who came up with the dimensions, the idea of the concept, well, not the idea, but he solved the whole thing around the L system, that how big of a bayonet does a camera need, so you can make any lens like fisheye and 1600 millimeter lenses, whatever, and it still fits to that system. And the great thing about the system is also it's made so the distance to the sensor make it possible to use also the N lens on small compact cameras like the TL. And so that's really amazing. And what also the L system allowed for is lens perfection, because now you can make huge lenses. And it's like you look at the L lenses for like a SL system, it's just there's no limit for how big the lenses are. I mean, you have a long zoom like this, and you have a 50 meter is a chunk like this. It's kind of like unreal big. But the great thing about that is that it allows a lens designer to make perfect optics. And so that's what they've been doing. And one of the things they said, okay, we're going to make upper lenses. So they make 50, 35, everything is upper. And this is like tailor lens technology. It's almost like, you know, we go to the moon, and then out of that comes pots and pans with NASA technology. So it's a little bit the same here, that Leica makes L lenses, and then out of that comes technology that actually now is being used in the M lenses. And the 35 mm Arbo is basically a very, very, very compacted, very reduced design of the 35 mm Arbo for the L system. And you see the two next to each other is just is unreal, that it's the same, it's almost the same quality. And that is kind of, you could say that's the logic of it. I find it a little bit funny that Leica and Canon and everybody else will make new, you could say mirrorless cameras with huge lenses. And it's kind of like the SLR is coming back, but now it's without the mirror, so it's SL system. But it's coming back when everybody was going to smaller and smaller cameras, smaller and smaller mirrorless. And now we go back and we want big cameras again. And it doesn't make a lot of sense, but it did make sense in the way that it's an excuse to make a new camera system. And it actually worked for Leica, and that's why Canon and everybody else copied and said, wow, we're going to do the same and with the Nikon Z or Nikon C, copied the same concept because it sells cameras. But if you look at the likely future, then you could say everything is becoming smaller and smaller. And with that, I mean that if you look at a telephone in the 90s or the 80s and the technology there, and you see how much you can pack into an iPhone or smartphone today, and it gets smaller and smaller and more compact. And the same, you can have an Apple Watch or something where it's actually a computer on your arm. So the ability to make things small with high precision, that's one of the things we see in lens technology that is really beneficial. And that's also that if you make big lenses, you have big glass, so you have less tolerance in the grinding and also in assembling. But the grinding and assembly is actually extremely precise. So then when you transfer that technology, you get a 35 Arbo that is almost or maybe even as good as the big 35 for the SL system. And that is thanks to precision. And it also points in a direction that, no, it would actually be possible to make more compact and small lenses, because it's possible now with the precision grinding and precision assembling that you can do. So you could say a lot of technical things about this 35 mm Arbo you can go into. The fundamental of it is that it's a new lens and it's amazing, as some people would say. So that makes you interested in trying to use it to get hold of one. They're so limited now, so maybe I get saved by the belt, because maybe once I can get one, I'll get over it, so I don't need it anymore. But right now is something, yeah, I want to see this thing. I want to play with this, and maybe there's something in it. And it has one extra thing going for it that is really, it's very Leica and it's very interesting. And that is that you can close focus. So most lenses can focus down to 70 centimeters or 1 meter. That's like three to 4 feet. This one you can go even closer. And it has a little bit like the thing we saw with like a Q, that you can turn the macro and then change the, then it's like a different mechanical thing that come in. It's something like a kind of invented back when it did, like the 3-Elmer, where it's like three lenses and one is, you turn it and then something mechanical happens inside, so it becomes a different lens. So this 35mm Arbor have this thing that you focus down to 70 centimeters, and then you press it a little bit and you get over to the grayscale of the focusing distance, and you can go really close, you can go 30 centimeters. And that's, it's going to be fun in itself. I don't know how much use it is or anything, but it's just one thing you want to try, and it's amazing that they did it, and also that it's possible to do a lens design that is so great and so perfect, and then you can also, by the way, you can also go closer. Then it's 2.0, so that's a little bit boring, but maybe not. That's hard to say. I think it's almost like you get this one and then that's several problems. It's like, okay, I like 50, but I actually want this 35. But then you get that 35 2.0, then you want a 1.4 35. And then in the future, hopefully there's a 35.08 Noctlux coming from Leica, also for the M system. And then you're like, yeah, it never ends. And as you can hear, I haven't solved my dilemma on this. I'm very fascinated by the way the lens design goes with Peter Carver. And I'm very happy that you could say the M system haven't been given up. Like Leica have invested a lot of time and everything into the L system. But the great thing is that what they learned from the L system is now used in the M system and is very compact lenses. As it should be, and that is one of the great things about the M system is that it's very simple. It's so simple that it feels like there's no camera between you and the person or the landscape or whatever you're photographing, and that's very ideal. It's almost like using a pen on a paper, that you don't think about the camera, you just think about what you're looking at there and the vision you have. So that's a great thing, and that's why the M system is important. It should be kept alive. It's also amazing to touch, and you drop it, it gets bent, and you pick it up, it keeps shooting, it doesn't fall apart that easy, and it stays actually in high value, even if it's digital. I think that's all I want to say about the 35mm Apo. If and when I get hold of one, I might take some pictures with it and do an article or do a video more. But so far, that's all I want to say now, and I hope you're less confused after this than I am. As always, you can go, there's a link below the video. There's a link to a free ebook if you sign up for my mailing list, and there's also links to my Leica definitions and other things. You can go in and read the definitions of Apo, aspherical, and stuff like that. Till I see you next time, thank you for watching, and remember to always wear a camera. Thank you.